Hello and welcome to Video Revealed. I'm Colin Smith. We're going to look at mixer automation in Adobe Premiere Pro. I've got several requests on how to do automation using the mixer in Adobe Premiere Pro. We're going to go over that and also a little bit on the clip mixer. It's important to know that you don't need to do this. You can manually add keyframes, which quite frankly is what I do. It's much more accurate. It just doesn't allow any real-time expression, but it still does give you a lot of control. But let's go look at automation using the mixer. So in the timeline, I have an audio file, and I'm going to call up my mixer. In the window menu, audio track mixer is not showing by default. So I called that up, and I've got that here. And you can see I have audio one and master. If you've got more tracks, they'll show up. You'll also notice that all these tracks have an off, read, latch, touch, and write. And by default, they're all set to read. That means if you do have keyframes already set manually in the timeline, then they will read automatically. It's important to understand that these are track mixer effects. I'll get to the clip mixer in a second. Let's turn on track mixer keyframes, which are not on by default. And we have to open up our track large enough. You're waiting to see something over here. And eventually, there it is. By default, these are set to clip keyframes, but I'm going to turn on track keyframes volume. It doesn't look like anything has changed here, but it has. And you'll notice that it keeps going past the clip. So this is strictly for the track. Now, let's turn on write. And I'm going to write keyframes. I'm going to start with my audio down at the bottom. I'm going to hold this down here and tap the space bar to start playback. And I'm writing those keyframes. And I'll tap the space bar to stop. And you can see we've written those keyframes in here. If I go back to the beginning, you'll notice on the mixer, it's now at the bottom. And if I hit play again by tapping the space bar, you'll notice that it moves up. Pretty easy, right? The confusion happens when you want to go back and change this. So that's where the read, write, touch, latch, on, off modes come from. If I turn this to off and go back, it's not going to read them. It's going to stay at the position that I had. By default, it changes to touch. And the touch means that it's going to read the keyframes that are there. As soon as I touch the mixer, it's going to write new keyframes for me. And when you release the mixer, it's going to go back to the ones we've had in here. So I'm going to take this up higher than the midpoint. And then when I let go, it's going to come back down to this reading here. Which if we read this setting here, we're there around that point. Okay, so I'm going to take this back, put it on touch. I'll hit play. It's reading the keyframes. We get near the end. I'll grab a hold of it and I'll lift it up. And when I let go, you can see it comes back down. You might also notice here that it didn't jump back down. This is smart. If it jumped back down, then as soon as you let go of the fader, it would unnaturally snap back to a lower value. So it's set to, when you let go, slowly go to the next value. So that's touch. Latch, if we look at latch, let's do the same thing, except when I get to this point here, I'm going to leave it high up. Okay? So latch is going to read it. Latch is reading it. I'll grab it here. I'll take it all the way up. I'll go past that mark and I'll let go. And now when I stop, you can see the latch kept going all the way. Okay, so latch reads the keyframes, but it will keep at the last level that I'm holding. So I had it all the way up to the top. When I let go, it stays at the top and it will stay for the remainder of that you're playing. If you hit stop, then it's going to stop at that point. Let's show you what happens if we try write and do the same thing. So let's go back to the beginning. And first of all, you notice when I hit write, it didn't read the keyframes that were there. It's writing that. And if I hit play, it's going to, oh, it went back to touch. So if I keep this on write, it's going to keep that level. So it does not read those keyframes. All right. Now for the audio clip mixer, if we go and look at the audio clip mixer, there's only one setting and that's writing the keyframes. So it's the same thing as write. There's no touch and latch modes, but it will write that on the clip mixer, which you have to go back in here and turn on the clip keyframes. But let's stay here with the automation keyframes. All right, so we've got that. I want to do a new automation. And I want to show you what happens. I'm going to take this down to the bottom. And I'm going to go up and down several times. Okay, so you see my automation is in here. If we zoom into this, you're going to notice that there's lots of keyframes. If we look in the preferences, which is in the edit menu on Windows, the Premiere Pro menu on the Mac, and go to preferences, audio, you'll see that there's a setting in here for linear keyframe thinning and minimum time interval thinning. Linear keyframe thinning means that if there are two keyframes, if there are two positions on the fader that are the same, it won't write a second one. So it will only write the changes. You might as well leave that one on all the time. The thinning one is a little bit more important. By default, it's turned off. So every movement you make is writing all of those keyframes, which can get a little unruly if you have to go back and edit those. So if we change the minimum time, right now 20 milliseconds is very, very short. Let's take this to 100 milliseconds. Okay. So I'm going to copy the track again and open this up. So we're going to have two versions of this. So I'm going to do the same version. I'm going to mute the first track, go to my second track over here and write that information. And I'll follow the same automation, up, down, up, down, with the thinning on. So let's watch what happens. Again, I'll start from the bottom. Well, we've got to turn on our track keyframes. So you can see with 20, there's not much of a difference. Let's go change that to something more drastic. Let's change it to 1,000. It can go up to 2,000. All right, so let me do the same thing. I'm going to write again on audio track 2. And now look what we've got. It's incredibly efficient. It's only writing the differences between 1,000 milliseconds. So you can see there's one there and there's one there. If you do want to edit these, my suggestion is to use the pen tool. The pen tool is easier to edit these, and I'll have a link to my tutorial on how to change these to Bezier curves. But you can select multiple keyframes in here and move them around with the pen tool. But that's how the automation works inside Adobe Premiere Pro. So the clip mixer has just the right property, but the track mixer has read, write, latch, and off. So depending on how you want to write your automation, you really do have all of your choices. And those kinds of things are standard on a lot of mixing automation, the latch and write. They might name them differently, but that's how you do automation and for mixers inside Adobe Premiere Pro. If you're new to Video Revealed and you think this was useful, take a moment and subscribe. If you want to support us some more, we've made it very easy by allowing you to donate one time or monthly via PayPal. You can do it in the description of this video or on the main page. We really do appreciate all of the wonderful people who are supporting us here on Video Revealed. Until next time, I'm Colin Smith, and I'm listening to your requests and getting you to sound your best.